and it believes it can answer these questions with certainty. In accordance with these questions, standard aesthetics describes the styles, forms, and historical epochs of art in a broadly realist manner, for it believes it is possible to define both art and philosophy. A central and founding principle of aesthetics remains unnoticed in these questions and gathers them together. What I call the principle of sufficient aesthetics. This principle grants the sufficiency, the relevance, and the validity of philosophy, of its classical principles, and the task it sets itself in relation to art, and which it sets for art itself. It will be said that this proposition of non-standard aesthetics, is useless, and that it goes without saying. However, one needs only to recall Socrates' decree that philosophy is the most beautiful of music, or that it is the best reader of the poets, thanks to those philosophers who reduce poems to their skeletal sense, in order to concern oneself with the deep intention of philosophy with regard to poets and artists, an intention which is perhaps only in the back of their minds. What is at stake here is not merely a matter of description, but an historical and theoretical normality more or less disguised. It is a question of the capacity of art to reach the real and to access the achievement of a human life across its works, of a telos which exceeds the detail of a work in order to determine the human destination of art. In reality, the philosopher intends, in a certain way, to take the place of the artist, to sing in his other, on her place, not of course in order to create work of art, but to fulfill the highest end which carries each work and which constitutes the philosopher's fantasy. This attempt at substitution is played out on the plane of art's finality, but not on that of its methods and of techniques. There, the philosopher is at a loss, even if he hides this fact from himself, imagining an art without art, a work without technique, thinking as the artist acts.
I'm going to skip a paragraph now.
The philosopher and the artist must, in effect, work according to their own separate logics, avoiding hybridity at any cost, acknowledging this division of labor. Too often, however, they put this division to bad use precisely on the basis of the principle of sufficient aesthetics. Between them, there is a mimetic rivalry, Girard, creating conflicts and which is generally harmful. It is necessary to conserve and transform this rivalry, conjugating each by distinguishing their respective techniques and ends. I do not speak of hybridization. I hesitate to employ this biological-colonial concept, but of another operation of scientific origin. What is called a conjugation of variables, a concept which gives the rivalry an entirely different sense or another use, not as a dialectical overcoming, in other words, according to ends of philosophy, but as a liberation of the subject of this conjugation.
I'm going to the next paragraph.
In the spirit of quantum thought, the task then consists in finding a theoretical apparatus or montage inclusive of and conjoining the two opposite sides so as to force them to cooperate in spite of themselves. Cooperating against one's will amounts to a kind of forcing into transforming mimetic rivalry or resistance, which are fuzzy and indefinite concepts, by way of constraining conditions of knowledge that, by the same token, represent a universal expansion of aesthetics. There are two theoretical couples we have to combine: art and philosophy, or aesthetics, a rather philosophical couple, and the couple philosophy and science, a more scientific than philosophical couple. There are obviously two separate operations or effects to conjugate. So we need what is called a matrix-based processing of aesthetics. What are the operations to be effected upon these two couples via the matrix? The first one is a kind of compulsory scientific forcing. For us, this is merely the initial move, whereas it is a complete operation for example, Badiou, for whom forcing consists in reducing truth, which is by definition infinite, of it is that, if it that of an idea, to a finite and classifying knowledge so as to render it adequate for a subject that can use it and transform himself with it. Our problem is slightly different, but it is not. It is still a matter of reducing aesthetics relations of rivalry, which are indefinite and reflexive in their own way, and stand up to scientific relation whose model is provided by quantum physics. Still, these relations are not simply classificatory, nor of the order of physical quantities, such as position and impulsion, since they are as quasi-scientific relations partially co-determined by philosophy in its engagement with art. We will then approach philosophical concepts or act and artistic acts as two kinds of variables or even properties supported by a subject X to which we have decided to apply them, but without yet knowing what justifies this operation. It is an in itself without a for itself, to speak like Hegel. Even if originally these are not forms of knowledge or properties, the quantic or scientific matrix requires that they be considered as such. These acts are not forms of knowledge, but the matrix obliges us to treat them as forms of knowledge, acting as variables or properties to this subject, object X. The matrix then forces us to multiply the one by the other, as to increase the total power of aesthetics. So we obtain two inverted mathematical products, art, philosophy, art. It is an operation of scientific translation on both sides of non-standard aesthetics. What we get is the reduction of a standard aesthetic idea or truth, always difficult to conceptualize, into the condition of a knowledge at last accessible and susceptible to being mastered. From unnameable truth to veridical nomination, it nevertheless remains an exterior and an intelligible operation. The second operation is stranger, and yet it retroactively justifies the first one and gives it its generic or universal character, no longer within the limits of philosophy, but within those of science. The question now is how to combine not art and philosophy, but aesthetics and science, in order to complete the integration of these complex aesthetic properties within science, within the immanence it is capable of. Properties that were scientific in itself must become so for itself. Clearly, the recourse to Hegel here is not to his philosophy, since the for itself is realized on a scientific mode, not a dialectical one. The main point is the identity of art and philosophy, which were considered scientific only from an exterior purview as presupposed properties.